Okay, hi everyone. Welcome to this session. Wow, what a panel. Great. Thank you for being here, everybody. Now, you know you have a good topic. Now, you know you have a good topic to discuss when the opinion about it in a given room tends to be mixed, even polarized. Now, native advertising is one such subject. There are two schools of thought, very distinct schools of thought, that dominate the discussion around native advertising. Now, one says it's an interesting format, but it tends to be awfully difficult to scale. And then there's this converse counter school of thought that says, it's fair to criticize it now, but eventually it is going to emerge victorious. So the question, the big question really is, will native advertising emerge victorious? And will it deliver the kind of scales, the scale and the revenue that publishers are expecting it to? So let's jump right into it. I'll start with Vineet. Right, because you're right next to me and you're my favorite. So, Vineet. Oh,
sweet, thank you.
Yeah. Now, see, when it comes to scale, is it really just about proving to the advertiser that this will deliver? So, native advertising is a very tricky format. How do you prove to an advertiser that you can scale it? How do you start? Let's go right to the basics.
Ashwini, like you rightly said at the beginning, that there is, two different kinds of opinions about native advertising, but I must tell you that I'm one of the believers.
Okay.
And so for me, I think it's not just about native advertising. I think this was true even for digital advertising a few years ago, where it's not about the format of the advertising, it's about being able to get that format correct. So in my opinion, I think there is a great future for native advertising, but there are these critical four pillars of native advertising which are very, very critical, and I'm sure we'll talk about this more, but just to highlight them, for me it's relevance, transparency, targeting, and storytelling. So if we're able to get these four pillars in place, I think native advertising has a brilliant future.
Okay. Now, Prasanna, I'll come to you. You can add on to that as well, but I do have another question for you, that we keep reading that click-through rates for native ads are much higher on mobile. Right now, what can a publisher really do with this information? We're talking about actionable things a publisher can really do. How do you make good on this information?
I didn't get the first part. You said they're higher on mobile.
They're higher on mobile. Yeah, I've been reading.
That's good news. That sounds good.
Right. So what do you do with?
Okay. See, the shift to mobile was inevitable.
Yeah.
Because everybody is accessing on mobile today. I think one of the biggest challenges publishers face, and I've thought about this a long time before the word data was coined.
Okay.
For example, when we used to start selling stuff beyond advertising, for me, anything we could create which would be relevant for our readers, which editorial does not normally do, would be very nice if somebody wants to sponsor that. For example, if I'm selling, I was in AFAS for a while,
yeah.
And if I'm selling, let's say we were focusing too much on television and print. Now there's somebody in out-of-home industry. He doesn't get covered at all because that's not priority. If you could get it covered well, you'd be very happy and somebody would sponsor it. It's not like we're talking about that person. So that, as it turns out, became native in one form. The other thing, the challenge was that, you can't compromise on quality just because it's not editorial. I think there's been a huge pushback from traditional legacy media firms in terms of the quality part of it, because the traditional editorial guys naturally kind of push back against it. And today you've got all these brand studios and the rest of it coming up, which I think is a bit of a pity, because to me, native has to be as good and sometimes even better than editorial. Then mm-hmm. Everybody's happy, it's super relevant. Fundamentally, you have to serve your consumer what he really finds useful. So if they can solve that problem, fantastic.
Okay, great. And
so you've got a company like LinkedIn because of that, which is not a traditional, it's not a legacy media firm or something.
Right.
So they have the best case studies in terms of what we've done for B2B advertisers and how it works, and they make good stuff when it works well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what happens then.
Great, thanks. Now, since you mentioned LinkedIn, I'll go to Virginia. I'll bring you in at this point. I want to ask you, Virginia, is the future of this format of native advertising really pushing this content through ad networks? Because I know LinkedIn has invested a lot of effort behind the audience network recently, because there's this idea that LinkedIn is a walled garden and that the reach is not enough if you advertise only on the platform through native. So now, through your audience network, these ads, these sponsored posts can appear on third-party publishers, on apps. So is this the future? Is this how we're going to scale native?
I think it's actually one of the ways that native will scale, but the genesis of this was not driven by a revenue revenue pressure. It was actually demand by clients. So LinkedIn, you know, we made a pretty dramatic pivot from mostly display in India, you know, up until, you know, I joined the team last April. And, you know, we were still seeing a lot of our dollars come in through display and spotlight ads and taking over the LinkedIn page, but mostly banners. And we made a strategic decision to move all of our display inventory onto programmatic within 6 months. And so suddenly, you know, we said, okay, we're going to go all in with native, we're going to go all in with sponsored content. And it's grown the business dramatically, like 30%+ when we made that shift. So we're selling less products. We reduced our portfolio and we said we're going to go all in, and it actually grew our business better because we could focus on quality experiences for members. Now, to answer your question, what was happening is as you grow the business, the clients were realizing that the same members consuming content on the platform at the high engagement rates were also consuming 8 to 10 pieces of content, and they were taking, you know, a period of time making their business decisions. They were coming to LinkedIn, then they were going to Forbes, and they were going to Fortune. And so how do you follow that same member through their buyer journey? And not all of it happens on LinkedIn. But you can, they want to be able to follow the member. They want to know who that member is and what their buyer journey is. And that kind of conversation with clients made us realize, well, this is really valuable. If I can actually help you reduce your sales cycle by providing branded content throughout your buyer journey of 4 or 5 platforms, you know, this could be really beneficial to the client. So I think the real way to scale is as you start your native business and you start delivering value to your clients, start figuring out sort of what are their clients consuming and where are their clients going. If their clients are going to events, if their clients are going to consultants, if their clients are going to commerce sites, you need to kind of follow that buyer journey. The second part of scale is, yes, one is through the network, but second is also thinking about your platform. LinkedIn is a heavy app.
Right.
It works on our phones, right? We all have presumably pretty fancy phones. But if you think about it, LinkedIn Lite, which is a much lighter version of LinkedIn with simpler features, also has a huge amount of potential to have native content for tier 2, tier 3 cities and grayscale workers and people who may not have the 10,000, 15,000, 30,000 rupee phone, but may have the 5,000 rupee phone with less memory. So one way to scale is to also think about how heavy your current mobile app is. You have to go mobile if you want to scale. There's no two ways about that.
Okay, great. Now, Puneet, I'll get you in at this point. When it comes to scaling native advertising, there's an argument that says it has a very bright future on a specialized site, on specialized sites in general, given its nature. Right? But as we discussed yesterday, there was an entire panel on how specialized sites can scale. You know, so they're in their own struggle for scale. So is this a bit of a quandary? How do you look at it, you know, given that Times Internet is a constellation with several specialized sites?
I want to take it back slightly. And there are multiple definitions of native advertising, right? And the question of whether native can scale on a standard site or a specialized site really depends on what native you're talking about,
okay.
Right? So if we say native is like a content marketing link, like people do on Outbrain and Taboola, native can scale very easily. Because all you have to do is to pump more dollars, figure out a higher reach, you get a better CTR, as you mentioned in the first part of your question.
Right.
Right? And it scales for both a given publisher and the brand as well, right? But when it comes to the real native, which is a pure immersion in the public publisher's ecosystem, right? When I can design a custom solution for my audiences, which is different from a Times of India solution being different from a Scoop Whoop solution, right?
Okay.
And I'll tell you why that is important. Because the Scoop Whoop audience and the Times of India audience is different. The audience wants to consume both advertising and content differently on a platform. So can I create a story on Times of India which the consumer is going to remember? That bit takes a larger time to scale. And the reason is because it's custom. It has to be done for each case separately. You know, we need to build a branded content studio. We need to figure out the needs of each advertiser. It's not a banner. Banner can scale, right? Custom solutions, by definition, need more time to be built, and there is a lot of discrepancy in how these are measured. For these solutions to scale, we have to agree on what is the measurement criteria. Are we measuring native on clicks? Are we measuring native on conversions?
Exactly.
Are we measuring native on time spent or engagement, right? Or likes and shares and everything. So that's the second most important part of scaling native.
Okay.
The third is the guidelines. What are the broad guidelines that is acceptable to everyone? And once A and B are solved, then we bring in technology to scale it.
Okay. Great, thank you. In fact, I was going to ask Anurag this exact same question that I asked you, and another one for you, that is it just a matter of standardizing this entire format? Do we need guidelines in place going forward? Is that the way to scale it?
So I think, you know, fundamentally, I would kind of, you know, just take a couple of steps back and, you know, the discussion of native, you know, and where it is and how will it scale, is it scalable or not? You know, any new technology, any new format that comes disrupts something or the other, right? You know, when we started digital advertising, it was banners, large formats. Then, you know, there was search, which came in contextual, so many other things, right? So native is, you know, another disruption, really. And so, I mean, if I say disruption, in the offline world earlier, we used to call it advertorial, you know, content-led advertising solutions. But if you really ask me, and if you look at the numbers today, and native, like Puneet was talking about, is different kinds of natives. It could be social, it could be on a content site, it could be a native video, right? Essentially giving a seamless experience to the user. That's what how a native ad unit is defined. The growth of native as a category, right, has been exponential, has been much larger than the display in the past 3 years or so. Remember, it's still a much more newer format compared to, let's say, the traditional banner advertising. So therefore, the question is that, is it growing faster than display? Yes. Would it, over the next 2-3 years, continue growing faster than display? Definitely yes, right?
Okay.
A disclaimer, we at SVG sell represent Outbrain in India, so we've seen growth rates coming across. You know, why are advertisers loving native is that they're able to, whatever matrices they are, right? And it's not for every advertiser, right? Every advertiser has a different need, but what we've seen is across, right from consumer products to consumer durables to electronics to e-commerce to even, you know, pharma companies, right? These advertisers are seeing higher engagements, CTRs, more time spent on site, whichever metrics they're looking at, native is measuring very favorably. So therefore, which is why more dollars are getting pumped into it. And will it continue scaling? Yes, as I, you know, technology is just an enabler, right? So where there is demand and there is enough supply also in the publishing world, enough inventories. So, you know, it will continue scaling up. Technology will aid. Whether it is standardization, yes, some standardization has to come in because, you know, like, you know, Puneet was saying that, you know, you have boutique solutions, which of course have their own value, right? They give a very immersive experience. But if you're looking at very scalable solutions to be deployed at mass, you need technology-led offerings, and that is where native is fitting in into very beautifully. It is already having some sort of guidelines, some sort of, you know, by Outbrains and Taboolas and other players of the world.
Right. Prasanna, you tell me, what you know, we were discussing this offline as well, and let's pick up from where Puneet and Anurag left off, that what is the best way to measure ROI? You know, he did enumerate three. So what is the best way to measure engagement for native? And I'd like Vineet to weigh in on this as well, you know. We're down to specifics now. Let's keep it very specific. How would you measure it?
Vineet, you spend the money first.
Yeah, sure.
First,
of course.
No, first of all, I think it would be slightly unfair to native advertising in general to so very quickly arrive at, you know, assessment of immediate ROI. Because like I said at the beginning of my statement, and this is not true just for native advertising, I think it's true for a lot of formats of digital content. If we see digital content in short films, in videos, you know, there are tens of millions of dollars of venture capital money going into you know, that segment, but that segment is still struggling with any kind of monetization. So I think let's not jump the gun. I know ROI is important. We at Magnon TBWA, we work with our clients and, you know, we are answerable to them about the ROI. But what is important over here to understand is that if we try and introduce too many rules right at the beginning, we are ourselves going to be the biggest hurdle towards ROI. And just to take off from, you know, Prasanna made some very wonderful points, but one point which I want to, you know, differ a little is, I do not think that native advertising or the content has to be even more stringent what 100% editorial content is. Because I feel, consumers are probably very, very open to seeing that kind of content. And Virginia, you know, talking about LinkedIn, so an example was coming to my mind that when we are on LinkedIn, we are there with a perspective of, you know, mostly people spending time on LinkedIn are looking to network or do something positive for their career. And if in that, while I'm spending time, I see an ad for a strategic leadership program at Harvard, you know, I think that is something that I would be very, very open to, despite knowing that it is not 100% editorial. So to answer your question right. on ROI, I think larger sites like Facebook and Twitter, I'm sure they've already started generating high quality of ROI. As far as the more specialized players are concerned, I think we need to give it a little more time.
Okay, great.
I just add to that.
I
think we heard a bit of that yesterday also. So I think you've got problems at both ends. One is on the publisher side, of course, you don't want to be measured straight away. Be it time spent, could it be engagement, could it be views, and the jury's out on that. Also on the brand side, there's a bigger challenge because when you go opt for native advertising, so you've replaced editorial guidelines with brand guidelines. And the fact is, and since we're talking digital here, and we pointed that out specifically on a site like Vidifeed, for example, we find that, look, we understand what works. And as a brand, you've got to give, for native at least, give some more leeway. You can't bring in your legacy rules on, guard everything around my brand like a dog, like a really tough guard dog, and not let it happen. So that prevents you from doing what exactly you're good at. And that, I think, is a huge challenge for brands to also change their mindset a bit.
Yeah.
So make a little bit of a, I don't know if this is controversial or not, but let me say it anyway, because I think we sit right in the middle of specialized and being a large player. I think unless we take on the ROI conversation as a specialized player, we're not going to be able to break the duopoly, right? Okay. So if you look at the level of, if you go and set up an ad in Facebook today for native, they will tell you exactly how many impressions to expect. They will give you that data. So I don't know whether we have the luxury as not being Facebook and not being, Google, to not have a point of view on ROI. Now, whether you set up those standards on your own terms, for example, for us, we use the content marketing score where you're compared to a peer set within a certain group of professionals. You want to move the needle for your brand amongst career starters versus CXOs. We have a different way to measure it, but we have a way to measure it. It doesn't have to be, we don't believe in CPCs, we're not in a banner-based world anymore. But I would challenge you all, if you want to scale this thing and you want to get dollars, because right now, everyone in this room is talking about the 10% that Facebook and Google don't have. Scale will come from us if it's a $1.1 billion industry, if native is about $150 million, right, in India, right? If you add up all the revenue of everybody in this room, we're competing for the crumbs over here. So my only statement would be is that I think that we have to put a little bit of urgency because otherwise it's going to continue to be what it is. So a little bit of disruption, I think any startups looking at ways to do measurements would be a great service to some of the specialized players, because I think otherwise we're going to be kind of playing this game on the sidelines. Just my 2 cents on
that. So. Puneet, you had a point earlier. Please make
it. I just quickly want to make a point.
Yeah.
Right. Native is, as I said earlier, is more psychological, correct? And the metrics that we have to measure native have to be around that. Most of us would remember the first 3 stories that we were told in our lives. We don't remember the first 3 advertisements we saw in our life. Right? So native is about telling a story. It's about creating a lift in the mind, right? So that when I have to paint my house, I remember Asian paints. I'm not painting my house today, but when I want to paint my house, I remember Asian paints. When I have to invest, I remember mutual funds, right? That's the true value of native. And I don't think we can today start measuring it with clicks and conversions.
Okay, okay. Now, we can't have a conversation on native advertising without addressing pretty much the proverbial elephant in the room, which is credibility and ethics, you know. Now, because of this young native advertising format, even the edit content which is not sponsored comes under the scanner. And that kind of leads to another discussion about the credibility of the entire publication. So is it a little unfair that it's such a young format and already we're having discussions around these big dangerous words like credibility and ethics for the entire newspapers that run it? So, and of course, dot-coms in this context. So where do you stand on this? What can we do to tide over this skepticism?
Can I take this question?
Yes.
Yeah, so if you remember, Ashwini, the first thing that I said, you know, in the opening comments was the four pillars I mentioned, and one of them was transparency. So I think what is very, very critical is that for consumers to, consumers consuming content, you know, in any form, on mobile, on web, or, you know, of the big players or the small, transparency is extremely important. To just give, an offline example, is quite like, you know, what maybe a Times of India does. So when we are reading a Delhi Times, we all know that it's probably all advertorial and hardly any, or I shouldn't say it, but very limited editorial input. But the fact is that even there, you would see a Consumer Connect initiative mentioned, you know, under an advertorial. So, and despite that, I feel that, you know, the effectiveness of that kind of content is far more credible, or at least a little bit more credible than a pure ad. There is, because the consumer knows there is some kind of editorial input that has gone in. So as far as in native advertising, we are able to keep it transparent. As far as our consumers know that there is going to be interspersed, you know, native advertising in our content, I think it's pretty acceptable.
Okay. Anurag, what's your thought on this? How can we tide over the skepticism that automatically comes with this format?
I think, you know, we are actually putting the horse, the cart in front of the horse here, that if you see any native advertising today, and Vineet rightly, talked about it, that you always have, you know, the boilerplates, you know, these are ads by Taboola, Outbrain, or Columbia, right? So the users know these are advertorials or these are native advertising units.
Are we on time? This is...
From that perspective, I don't know, and you know, technology also, the second part is technology allows certain publishers to control some kind of content, you know, which is coming in. Why only native? Why not programmatic? You know, there are a lot of all kinds of advertising content coming in through programmatic pipes. So there is some sort of control which is there, and I think the control, if it is really important for a publisher to have some more control, those tools would eventually, if not already available in certain platforms, would be there. So therefore, some sort of a filtering mechanism, some sort of a, automated, editorial, moderated controls should always, regulated. Would always be there.
Right.
So I really don't know whether it's such a large, problem area. You know, I think there are other larger problems to be addressed rather than this. That's my thought.
Do you agree?
Just quickly want to add one thing, right? So as everyone has already said, I think building trust with the audiences is the most important part of not falling for the problem that you are saying. But I just wanted to bring out another point. You know, while native is a term that we have started using on digital recently, it's been around as, Vineet, you talked about, native content on print, but the advertiser-funded programming on TV for years and decades has all been native, right? So as long as we call it out, I don't think consumers have a problem. They want trust from brands. And if you can give that trust and transparency, our consumers are good.
Okay, yeah, please.
So a little bit of a counterpoint over here. I think that the issue of trust is actually the reverse. It's in the world of, we just took part in a digital trust survey of trusted platforms. We have a lot of brands right now that are very skeptical of platforms that may have objectionable content, but, fake news, clickbaits, and actually the damage it does to a brand to feature their brand, their sponsored content on a platform alongside potentially violent content, sexually explicit content is more damaging. So actually this notion of brand safe environments where it's not so much about consumers wondering or not trusting the content because it's listed as sponsored content, it's more brands saying what is happening on your platform. What is the organic content and engagement and editorial? I was very happy to hear what Vignesh was saying. You know, editorial integrity, the trust in a team that says that, like, we actually vet all the content that's on our platform versus, you know, in social, this is a problem, right? Everybody's become a publisher. The number of fake news sites that have come up on articles, if, God forbid, one of the brands actually shows up next to a fake news article, you know, it can be very, very damaging. So I think what really needs to be sort of, and this is the responsibility of our ecosystem, which is not so much putting guidelines. Yes, you should get guidelines on marking sponsored content. But are there ways that we can better identify fake news? Are there ways that we can prevent our publishers from having their brands exposed by potentially damaging content? And I think Facebook and others now are taking steps towards that. But I think we have the work to do, you know, in our ecosystems too.
Okay, great. That's a great counterpoint. Prasanna, you're the only one who hasn't shared your thoughts on the ethics part. Why don't you?
Yeah, I think what you just said, that's, I think that's also part of the problem. The fact that we leave it to eventually Google and Facebook to set the rules. And unfortunately, we won't be able to change that. That's a fact. But I think one thing we kind of underestimate is the fact that audiences have changed a lot now. India is a very young country, and what we're seeing now is, if you called out, and these are not fools, these the readers are not fools, eventually somebody will point it out, everybody's a broadcaster, they can mangle your brand there. So this my feeling is, while fake news is one part of it, but the whole worry about the how the ethics of it might be a little overblown, that's something we think about too much. I think readers figure it out, and like I said, the brand owner, he would see the difference. He would know what not to do very quickly, and he would discover it. If he's doing something wrong, and incidentally, some of the biggest pressures to kind of bend the rules and do more come from there. When BuzzFeed started off, you could see content was highlighted very differently.
Yeah.
Today, they've stopped doing that. So it's not like they did it on their own. Somebody kept pushing them all the time. So it's just about finding the right balance.
Okay.
And I think they'll discover that.
Great, great. On that note, I think we have just enough time for audience questions. Yeah.
Really, because I have researched this a lot. The Federal Trade Commission in the US has very specific guidelines on native advertising. We have no such guidelines in India. Yeah. It's completely murky. I don't know if Satvik is here. Scoopoop gets, last I spoke to him, they get about 50-60% of their, and the reason native works is because it mimics editorial. It works by pretending to be close to editorial or like editorial within the same formats, fonts, style, design. So how can you say that ethics and credibility is not an issue with native? If that's not an issue, then why is MediaNet an issue? Why is paid content
it's
in newspapers
overblown.
An issue?
I'm saying it's slightly
not,
overblown.
No, it's not at all overblown.
I think
because if you
brands
not,
will stay away.
If you said sponsored content,
yeah.
Possible that half the readers won't look
no,
at
but
it.
You already have steps being taken, right? Google is saying, I've got the brand safe sites. You're working on those aspects. So that sifting is
has
already happening
IAMI
as we speak.
Has IAMI said anything? Have there been any complaints to ASCII? Because nobody knows that this is native advertising.
See, with our luck, we'll probably have TRA or somebody setting the rules at some stage. But
before that, the industry should move then.
But the industry changes very fast. Even Facebook doesn't get it right. They've been changing the rules every 4 months, five months.
FTC has given you a format. It's very, just read those guidelines. They are so specific. And I think we are getting away with blue murder, honestly, in India.
Can I just add to this? And I'll be very careful because you seem to be very passionate about this point. if I may just, you know, add, like you said, there are no guidelines. So the US, even for simple things like collection calls, you know, they have a very firm law called the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act. In India, those laws are very, very minuscule. So it's not just with native advertising. There are lots of such areas in the industry. Coming to your point, when you said the word that native advertising succeeds because it pretends to be like editorial, I beg to differ. Also because, you know, if you notice what Anurag said, that today all those ads that appear, they will have a Taboola or a Columbia, you know, mentioned over there. To also say that, you know, if we move away slightly from editorial kind of format of native advertising, we go to something like Zomato. When you're looking for restaurants on Zomato, you will see four restaurants which come as organic listing, and the fifth one is a sponsored listing. The consumer is aware that this is a sponsored listing, but is still open to exploring it. And I think the same thing holds true for native.
Five of you guys follow guidelines, but you have a huge industry out there. And I'm not saying guidelines is the answer because India has, like you said, we have laws for everything. The problem is we don't follow those laws. That's a separate issue.
I think, I recently heard the AIB team talk about the concept of integrating brands into content. And the reality is, we may all kind of chase guidelines and whatever, but the reality is that the only thing that moves the needle with brands and publishers is how the campaign performs. And the data pretty much shows that elegant, you know, buyer-centric way of integrating your brands into content actually delivers much better performance than if you force the brand in. So if you look at the way AIB integrated Ola into the New Year's video, that performs a lot better than any kind of... So I think in the case of India, having looked at the rules and had the broad discussions in the industry about bringing them here, even if you bring them here, our market is very demand-driven and very performance-driven. So what would be useful...
Entertainment content is a different... talking brand placement within entertainment content is a completely different kettle of fish. I'm talking about native advertising in web publishing, where if you're on a news site or you're on a site where, or on a health site, for example, and there is native slipped in between in the same font and design, and I wish we had shown examples, Ashwini, maybe we could do this next time. I am a reasonably cynical news consumer. I can't spot the difference at times.
So it would be the same as, so agree. I think the bigger problem is spotting the difference between real news and fake news. If you can solve the difference between real news and fake news, because right now, what is the credibility difference on how you spot it? If you see something that comes from a credible publisher, a news piece, you look at where it comes from, right, the platform, versus some random name of a publisher. So the problem presides in how do you actually distinguish what is real and what is not real versus what is branded, what is not. Now, one point, and we'll move on to the next topic, is in the case of B2B, something's really changed with the buyer behaviors where there's an expectation now of brands to be the educators and the ones that talk to the industry about what's going on in the industry. So for example, 10 years ago, a white paper by a technology publisher, it would be like if it didn't list it as, you know, from IBM or from Cisco, would be considered like, now there's almost an expectation that IBM does do content. So at least in the B2B world, which is where I can speak to, it's not considered like, you don't have to pretend to be editorial. You have to pretend to be your brand, or you have to be your brand, and you have to do your job of feeding the industry. And if you look at all the thought leadership content that's come out of some of the biggest players, whether it be in technology or financial services, I don't think it's a surprise that a lot of the banks or Amfi is getting involved in educating the market about financial services. It's their job as a brand to create that content. Now, you could argue, why don't they make it more clear that it's funded or whatever? It's the job of the brand to educate the market. So we can talk more about it. But I would agree with you that the guidelines should come soon. Who brings them here, I don't know.
Yeah. I just quickly want to add. I think it has to start from self-regulation. And you know, credible publishers would go the extra mile to ensure that they have clear disclaimers, right? It's an important line of revenue, but it's the credibility also it comes at stake if you don't do it the right way. So, you know, in our case, for example, we have left deals on the table because the advisor said they will not agree with us putting an ADVT on the listing and a big disclaimer on the top, right? So we have done natives on education, immigration, we have done natives on health, we have done natives on investments and everything, right? But if you look at what we do on Times of India, there's a big disclaimer on the top or the bottom of the article. Sometimes it's at both the top and the bottom. A lot of self-regulation is needed for this to grow, right?
Great. Do we have time for more questions? Oh, time's up. There's a gentleman who raised his hand there. One question.
I just wanted, not a question really. I think Vanita, the point that you made is an extremely important one. And I think it's also important that we differentiate between Ola integrating into AIB and pharma pretending to be editorial. I think it's extremely important that there are some areas which have more sanctity than others, right? And I think what you're saying is difficult to expect, Vanita, really, in India. But my belief is that the incumbents, the traditional media owners, I think will, my guess is, be more responsible, India Times and the Times of India, because I think the stakes are different for them. And I would expect that there is more self-regulation, particularly in sensitive categories where financial decisions are to be made, health decisions are to be made, business decisions are to be made. There are In finance, I think there are already strict guidelines on what can, cannot be done. And you see that there is some more sanctity there. But pharma, for example, in my opinion, is a big, big, people are getting away with blue murder there. I just wanted to say that. Thank you very much.
Sure. Great. We're out of time. So, yeah. Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you. Wonderful panel. Thank you.
Thank you very much.